नमस्ते बिटिया, माई सेल्फ जेवियन नेहा सैनी फ्रॉम फिजियोथेरेपी एंड डायग्नोस्टिक्स, ज्योति विद्यापीठ वुमेन्स यूनिवर्सिटी. हियर आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू अबाउट द एनाटॉमी ऑफ पैरोटिड रीजन एंड द पैरोटिड ग्लैंड. सो पैरोटिड रीजन इंक्लूड्स द पैरोटिड सलाइवरी ग्लैंड एंड द स्ट्रक्चर्स रिलेटेड टू दिस ग्लैंड. सो दिस इज द पैरोटिड रीजन. Parotid means surround the ear or close to the ear. So here we find the largest salivary gland, that is the parotid gland. Definition is, it is the largest of the salivary gland. The site is located below the auricle, occupying the region between the ramus of mandible and the mastoid process. It extends superiorly up to the zygomatic arch, inferiorly up to the angle of mandible, anteriorly up to the posterior border of masseter, and posteriorly it overlaps the anterior border of sternomastoid. Shape is pyramidal in shape, as we can see in the diagram. So here we can see the extension of the parotid gland. Above it, it extends up to the zygomatic arch, below up to the angle of mandible, anteriorly up to the masseter, and posteriorly you have the auricle. So these are the relations, or these are the extensions of the parotid gland. Then subdivisions of the parotid gland. It contains the main gland and accessory gland. Accessory gland lies above the parotid duct. Then there are capsules which are surrounding the parotid gland. These are derived from the deep fascia of the neck, that is the cervical fascia. Its superficial layer is attached to the zygomatic arch and extends to cover the masseter. And the deep layer is attached to the mandible, stellate process and mastoid process. A thickening of deep fascia extends from stellate process to the angle of mandible. This is known as stylomandibular ligament, and separates the capsule of the parotid from the submandibular gland. It is tense. Swellings of the parotid gland, these are very painful because the capsule is very tense and it is adherent to the gland. So here we can see the capsules of the parotid gland in the diagram. This is the parotid gland and this is the capsule which is surrounding the parotid gland. Now the relations of the parotid gland. Superficial relations include skin, superficial fascia, great auricular nerve, superficial parotid lymph nodes. Anteromedial relations lies the posterior ramus, posterior border of the ramus of mandible, and the muscles attached to the ramus, that is masseter on the lateral side and medial pterygoid on the medial side. Then we have posteromedial relations, which include mastoid process. Muscles attached to the mastoid process like sternomastoid, posterior valley of digastric, styloid process. Muscles attached to it like stylohyoid, styloglossus, stylopharyngeus. Carotid sheath and its contents. These include internal jugular vein, internal carotid artery, 9, 10th, 11, 12th cranial nerves. So these structures lies posteromedial to the parotid gland. And medially we have the pharyngeal wall. Now there are some structures which lie within the gland. They are the termination of the facial nerve. Facial nerve is the 7th cranial nerve, and the beginning of 5 terminal branches of the facial nerve. These are the most superficial structures of the parotid gland. Then terminations of the superficial temporal and maxillary veins, the whole of the retromandibular vein, and the beginning of the 2 divisions, then termination of the external carotid artery and beginning of its two terminal branches like superficial temporal maxillary artery. These are the deepest structures. Then deep parotid lymph nodes, these are embedded within the substance of the gland. So the structures within the gland, these are depicted in this diagram, the facial nerve, then the maxillary and the retromandibular vein, then the external carotid artery and its terminal branches. Now the structures which are passing, emerging from the parotid gland, these are including the terminal branches of the facial nerve, that is temporal branch, zygomatic branch, buccal branch, mandibular and cervical branches, as well as terminal branches of the maxillary artery, that is superficial temporal and the transverse facial artery, and the divisions of the retromandibular vein like posterior division and the anterior division of the retromandibular vein. Then this is the parotid duct, which is receiving the secretions of the parotid gland and transfer it to the mouth. Parotid duct is 2 inches long, and the course is, it emerges from the anterior border of the gland, it runs forwards and obliquely and lies superficially to the masseter and below the transverse facial artery and the accessory parotid gland. It terminates by piercing the buccal pad of fat, buccopharyngeal fascia, buccinator muscle and buccal mucosa. Then it opens into the vestibule of the mouth opposite the crown of second molar tooth, upper second molar tooth. The applied aspect related to this is the oblique passage of the duct acts as a valve-like mechanism and prevents the inflation of the duct during blowing. The surface anatomy includes, it is represented by the middle one-third of a line which extends from the tragus of the auricle to a point on the midway between the ala of the nose and the upper lip. So this demarcates the parotid duct. Then the nerve supply. It includes parasympathetic, which is secretory to this gland. This parasympathetic nerve supply originates from inferior salivatory nucleus. This nucleus lies in the medulla. Preganglionic nerve fibers run along the lesser occipital nerve, which is a branch of 9th cranial nerve. Then there is a ganglion, which is known as otic ganglion. Over here, these preganglionic fibers relay, and then from here, postganglionic fibers arises, which reach the parotid gland along the auriculotemporal nerve. Auriculotemporal nerve is a branch of mandibular nerve. Then the sympathetic innervation is via postganglionic sympathetic fibers, which are arising from the plexus around the external carotid artery. Then the blood supply. The arteries which are supplying to the parotid gland, it include external carotid artery and the vein is retromandibular vein. Then the lymphatic drainage. The lymph from the parotid gland drains into superficial and deep parotid lymph nodes and finally to deep cervical lymph nodes. Now the clinical aspects. The disease of the parotid gland, they may be congenital like aplasia or atresia. In this, any one or group of salivary gland may be absent. Either it may be unilaterally or bilaterally. Aplasia occurs for unknown reasons in conjunction with the development defects such as hemifacial microsomia and LADD syndrome and mandibulofacial dysostosis. Second is mumps. It is a viral disease of human species caused by mumps virus like paramyxovirus, transmitted by direct contact, droplet spread or contaminated objects. It is painful swelling of the parotid gland. Then there is Siala adenitis. This is the inflammation of the salivary gland and it may be acute, chronic or recurrent forms. Clinical features present painful swelling, reddened skin, edema of the cheek, lower grade fever, malaise. So these are the symptoms. Then salivary gland cancer tumor, or it is a cancer that forms in the tissues of the salivary gland. It is rare, with 2% of head and neck tumors forming in the salivary glands. So this is the salivary gland tumor. The causes, it may be chewing tobacco followed by smoking. Then sialolithiasis, also known as salivary calculi or salivary stones. It is a condition where a calcified mass forms within the salivary gland, usually in the duct or the submandibular gland, also known as Wharton's duct, less commonly in the parotid. Now the questions related to this chapter which can be asked in your exams, these are include: write short note on anatomical features of the parotid gland. So in this you have to mention all the structures which we have discussed right now. Then the nerve supply of the parotid gland, in this we mention about the parasympathetic and sympathetic innervations of the gland. Then for the exercise, you have to draw this label diagram of the parotid gland in your files. So this completes our topic, the parotid gland. Thank you.